My name is Sarah Quinton. I'm the curatorial director here at the Textile Museum of Canada, and it's my absolute pleasure to welcome you all here this evening for our evening that is called Staying Power. I didn't really realize when we titled the evening Staying Power that we were working on such a very jam-packed evening for you, so I hope your stamina is such that you all do have staying power. We certainly have an interesting evening ahead of us. As many of you know, the exhibition Sheila Hicks, Material Voices, has been on view here at the Textile Museum of Canada since October. And what a galvanizing exhibition this has been. We've been overwhelmed with school tours for all students of all ages, gallery tours for adults led by curators, volunteer docents, and educators. The exhibition has attracted a record number of out-of-town visitors, engaged workshop participants from our community outreach partners, Sistering, Workman Arts, Art Heart, and the YWCA, plus a partnership with the Textile Studio Co-op. We are most pleased to have had several critical and popular reviews, blog posts, and social media explosions. Our comment book is overflowing with thoughtful, personal, and insightful responses. It's a very moving and intelligent document of an exhibition. There are still 3 days left, so please continue to help us spread the word. We don't want anyone to miss this once-in-a-lifetime opportunity. A few catalogs will be available for sale at the end of the evening, and the exhibition will stay open until 9 p.m. today. It's an honor to acknowledge the extraordinary financial and intellectual support of Partners in Art. Many members are with us this evening. Welcome and thank you. The United States Consulate in Toronto and the Jack Weinbaum Family Foundation, particularly Carol Weinbaum. Thank you so much, Carol. Thanks and kudos also go to the Joslin Museum of Art in Nebraska and the exhibition curator, Karen Campbell. We could not have done this without any of you, and we look forward to working together on future projects. As always, I would like to acknowledge the ongoing support of the Canada Council for the Arts, the Ontario Arts Council, and the Toronto Arts Council. Last, but definitely not least, I want to thank Sheila Hicks. I want to thank her for being at the fore of the burgeoning field of textile arts when I was a student in the late 70s. And I want her to know that so much of the work I was engaged with at that time was so very heavily influenced by her profound appreciation of materiality, craftsmanship, and the expressive power of textiles. I want to thank her for sticking with it for all these years, for never letting go, and for wowing our Toronto audiences today with this exhibition. Sheila supremely wanted to be here with us this evening, but her schedule simply would not allow. She's 82 years old and she's working globally, internationally, night and day. None of us who don't spend night and day with Sheila knows quite how she accomplishes all that she does. She has asked me to share a message with you. In her classic, straightforward way, she says, "May all go smoothly tonight. I will be thinking of you and ask pardon for my absence." My response, thank you for being here with us tonight, Sheila. It's now my pleasure to invite Juan Alsace, Consul General of the United States in Toronto, to say a few words. Juan.
Thank you, Sarah. So I'm very happy to be back here at the Textile Museum of Canada on behalf of the U.S. Consulate General for this panel discussion on the inspiring legacy of Sheila Hicks. As Sarah mentioned, it was just back in October that we opened this exhibit, and I was here for that along with my wife Nancy and my colleagues from the Consulate, Hillary Claudia Medina. And we're here to talk about the inspiring legacy of Sheila Hicks, and it really is a tremendous honor. Really only 3 days before this important exhibition closes. So I'd like to thank the Textile Museum's Executive Director, Sarah Quinton, and Curator Susan Four for their excellent contributions and collaboration. I also appreciate the financial assistance of our other sponsors, Partners in Arts, and the Jack Weinbaum Family Foundation for making this exhibition a reality. You know, it's through our embassies and our consulates around the world that the U.S. Department of State supports cultural diplomacy through grants to museums such as this, non-governmental institutions, and artists, enabling U.S. content in exhibitions and the participation of American artists and performers in cultural programming. The consulate has been honored to financially support internationally renowned American artist Sheila Hicks. She wasn't here for the opening, she wasn't here for the closing, but she has good reasons, including the fact that she's 82 years old. So that's just tremendous that she just continues to do this work. We fund not only the installation and shipment of her works here and the public workshops with local partners, but also the cost of bringing our two American expert speakers who we have here today, Alyssa Author and Sarah Zapata, to participate in today's panel. And Sarah was just telling me this is her first visit to Toronto, so please make her feel warm. And of course, Alyssa's been here before, but she's a little chilly today, but I think you'll both enjoy Toronto. Now, Sheila Hicks, inspirational American master artist. Drawing on global weaving traditions, architecture, and her own inspiring personal history, among many other sources, Sheila's work in fiber reveals her remarkable understanding of color, line, and texture. And when Nancy and I toured it, and our colleagues toured it last, the complexity and the beauty of her work really is inspiring. And so I look forward to hearing from our panelists on her work. It's her ability to work with different communities on a variety of textile projects that has elevated the perception of textile as a simple material to an art experience situated between sculpture and performance. The project represents a valuable cultural exchange and partnership, enhancing understanding in Canada of U.S. history, cultural traditions, and themes around women's history and rights and entrepreneurial practice. The public workshops that Sarah mentioned also brought this exhibition outside of the walls of the museum to many other venues in Toronto, directly inspiring local artists and workshop participants. And you can appreciate how Sheila's art inspired these participants in the Community Voices exhibition, which will be installed until March 15th. I understand that exhibition has been a great success, and not only have many been inspired by her exhibition, but as Sarah mentioned, that the Textile Museum has also experienced record-breaking audiences and tour numbers. So tonight in the upcoming panel, we'll hear how Sheila's work inspires and influences, that by showcasing her work and story in exhibitions like these, that her art continues to inspire both American and Canadian artists. Thank you.
Thank you so very much, Juan. It is now my pleasure to introduce Alan Elder, this evening's moderator, who will introduce our two guest speakers. Alan is a research manager at the Canadian Museum of History. Previously, he held the position of curator, craft and design. His research focuses on Canadian craft and design activities from the early 20th century to the present, with a particular interest in the period immediately after the Second World War. Since joining the museum in 2002, Elder has worked on several exhibitions, including Japan, Tradition, Innovation, Cool 60s Design, Unique, 30 Years of Outstanding Crafts, and Harvesting Clay, the Bose Pottery in the 1940s. Elder has edited two books co-published by the museum. The first is Made in Canada, Craft and Design in the 60s, in conjunction with the Design Exchange and McGill-Queen's University Press, and Crafting New Traditions, Canadian Innovators and Influences with Harborfront Centre in 2008. Please join me in welcoming Alan Elder.
Thanks, Sarah. Consul General, Mrs. Elsasser, fellow textile enthusiasts. First of all, I'd like to thank Sarah and the staff here at the Textile Museum for the invitation to join you this evening. It's always my pleasure to come back to the Textile Museum. I've seen it through many years and the changes that go on, but have to laud it for the continuing excellence in its programming. It'll be my pleasure this evening to introduce our two speakers, and later on to moderate a discussion, and we hope you'll participate in that discussion. So I'd ask that you hold your questions until later in the evening, and we'll provide time for all of us to really chat about some of the issues that we're going to talk about. After Alyssa, the first speaker, there'll be a short break. So you can go and outside have some water or whatever, and then come back for the second part of the program. So it's my pleasure to introduce Alyssa Author. Alyssa is the Wingate Research and Collections Curator at the Museum of Arts and Design and at the Bard Graduate Center in New York City. She has published widely on a diverse range of topics, from the history of fiber art, the decorative in contemporary art and craft, feminist art, and the visual culture of the American counterculture. Talking about 60s. Author co-directs Feminism and Company, Art, Sex, Politics, a public program at the Museum of Contemporary Art, Denver, that focuses on issues of women and gender through creative practice. She is the author of String, Felt, Thread, The Hierarchy of Art and Craft in American Art, that was published in 2009. And this is an illustrated history of the use of fiber in the American art world during the pre-war period. So I'd like to hand it over to Alyssa. Welcome.
Thank you, Alan, for that lovely introduction, and I also would like to thank Sarah and her team for organizing tonight's event, and then also my deep appreciation for the support of the American Consulate. I wouldn't be here without them, and it's a pleasure to be part of the Textile Museum community this evening, speaking about the inimitable Sheila Hicks and the field of fiber art generally. Thank you for inviting me. So the title of tonight's program, Staying Power, is a perfect jumping off point for me because my presentation focuses on the history of the reception of fiber in the art world through the case study of the weavings and three-dimensional fiber sculpture of Sheila Hicks. Hicks has been at it as an artist for 50 years, talk about staying power, and her career trajectory parallels the history and development of the field of fiber. And sometimes I think, you know, I could teach the history of the fiber art movement with just her work. And I'll show you an example as to why. This is one of the earliest exhibitions that she participated in New York City. This is at the Museum of Arts and Design, then the Museum of Contemporary Crafts, in 1963, an exhibition called Woven Forms. It was really the first exhibition in the US to examine the so-called new fiber art. These were experimental weavings and then sculptures made in off-loom techniques. I'm showing you the catalog on the left hand here, two installation shots and a small work by Sheila that was very much influenced by her personal research into the history of indigenous off-loom techniques. Then I could jump to all the way to the 2014 Whitney Biennial installation in New York City with this work by Hicks called Pillar of Inquiry, Supple Column. And so recently, the contemporary art world finally caught up with Sheila's 50 years of innovation in fiber as a form of sculpture, and she has experienced being quote unquote rediscovered or discovered all over again. But this time within an art world that has historically been very dismissive of anything associated with textiles or craft. So she's been a trailblazer her whole life, and staying power is certainly a factor that needs to be taken into consideration when thinking about her recent late career recognition in the contemporary art world. It's very true that Sheila never gave up, nor did she compromise her vision to achieve success, and it's a point that I'll return to in just a little bit. Now, the phrase staying power can also be used to describe a particular feature of the art world, specifically this feeling that you can have that if you just live long enough, the art market's voracious appetite for something new will eventually loop back to devour everything it once despised or excluded. This view isn't completely false, but it can feel somewhat cynical as a way of approaching the art world because it's often too simplistic in terms of its conclusion. And I'm going to try to get away from that position tonight. And what I'm much more interested in exploring with you is what's changed in the art world between 1963, using that example of woven forms, and 2014, the Whitney Biennial, that allowed for Hicks's work to move from what was considered the periphery, that is the world of craft, to the presumed center, the world of contemporary art. So I'm going to approach the changing reception of her work as a barometer that reflects much bigger transformations in the art world that certainly include the art market, but can't be reduced to it. And ultimately, what I hope to describe is the extent to which today's art audience is likely more receptive to the salient features of Hicks's work than almost at any point since their creation. And that's a very interesting phenomenon to consider. Now, first, I want to give a little bit of background for those in the audience who might not know a lot about the art world that Sheila Hicks came up in. And if it's a repeat for you, it'll still be interesting because it is an interesting story. But I want everybody on the level playing field as we go forward. So in the late 1960s and 1970s, an extraordinary number of artists working in North America and Western Europe experimented with or adopted fiber as a primary medium in their work. And I'm just showing you three examples here. Starting on the left, Eva Hesse's work, Aeneid, from 1966. Faith Ringgold in the center, this is The Death and Resurrection of the Bicentennial Negro, from 1976. And Claire Zeisler's work from the Coil series, also from 1976. And let me just talk a little bit individually about these pieces. So I'm repeating Eva Hesse's piece here, and then a new work by Robert Morris. He was part of the same circle. It's an untitled felt work from the late 60s. So this was a groundbreaking movement because it demonstrated a profound shift in artists' interest in and approach to fiber, which had previously been dismissed for its historical associations to the decorative, to craft, to women's work. And these were all associations that reduced the medium of fiber to a non-art material. In other words, it put craft on the side of the losing end of the sort of high-low divide. And so this was a form of exclusion. In addition, the use of fiber in each of these spheres of practice, and let me just talk a little bit more about the others. So this is sort of a circle of New York artists that we sometimes associate with terms like process art or post-minimalism. This is Judy Chicago's dinner party, which included quite a bit of embroidery, quilting, et cetera, along with China painting, again with Faith Ringel's soft sculpture. They're exclusively associated in this period with the feminist art movement. And then a work here by Sheila Hicks on the left, and also the Claire Zeisler that I showed earlier. These were artists working in together in a community that was labeled fiber artists. It's not a term that they necessarily identified with, and I'll say a little bit more about that in a second. So the use of fiber within each of these spheres, whether it's the post-minimalist, whether it's the fiber-based, or whether the feminist, was received in very dramatically different ways in the 60s and 70s and into the 1980s, in fact. It was variously shaped by institutional, curatorial, and other local social forces that were tied to a long-standing, highly entrenched aesthetic ideology that divided art from craft. Now, despite their very different relations to power in the art world and orientations towards the medium of fiber, these artists utilized it with the shared aim of altering the dominant definition of art in the 60s and 70s. They were all very interested in their own ways about, you know, to probe, to shift, or to undermine that art-craft divide. So, for instance, fiber artists such as Sheila Hicks and Zeisler used fiber to create non-woven, three-dimensional work that, in their view, really liberated the medium from the loom and thereby released their work from the confines of fiber's historically low position in the art world. And their goal was, on some level, to win recognition for fiber as a medium with the very same expressive power attributed to the traditional media of painting or sculpture. This was a formidable challenge for them because they were regularly positioned as craft artists or fiber artists, which is to say that their identity as artists was always qualified by this term craft or fiber, which could be used as terms of exclusion. Going back to Hess and Morris, by contrast, artists in this circle, associated with process or post-minimalism of the 60s and 70s, really found forms of fiber such as rope or felt, which is what Morris is using on the right-hand side, they found it attractive for its ordinariness and other non-art attributes, which happened to be the very attributes that fiber artists were struggling to sort of free themselves from. So indeed, they loved fiber's everyday utility, its quotidian sort of ordinariness. And as such, they worked sometimes at cross purposes with fiber artists, undermining the latter's belief in arts like autonomy and preciousness and durability. So one group is dragging sculpture down to start rebuild it from scratch. The other group is looking to elevate fiber as a new form of sculpture. And then finally, feminist artists took yet another approach to fiber. They openly embraced its relationship to craft and women's artistic traditions. They tried to own it in ways that reduced what people thought of as like a shameful association. So for Chicago and Ringgold, among others, fiber in the found textiles, quilts, or needlework offered evidence of a distinct female artistic tradition that challenged the legitimacy of the hierarchy of the arts that subordinated craft to art. So this is a very, you know, short overview, but it's the scenario gives you some idea of the art world that Hicks was operating in at this time. Now, I'm just gonna go to a placeholder image here. Here we go. This is some of Hicks's work that's recently shown in New York City. So in the case of fiber art, the process of elevating one's work from craft to art was not an overnight maneuver. And taking Hicks as our case study, the process, as I hope you'll see, is a very long upward trajectory that began for her in the 1960s in craft and design-based context and continues today, although the end point I'm going to work with is her inclusion in the very prestigious 2014 Whitney Museum of American Arts Biennial, which is a kind of career-making exhibition for artists in the contemporary art world. And so using this extended trajectory of the reception of Hicks's work, I'll address a number of questions about the social and institutional dynamics that determine how art is defined and valued. And I'll also sort of broadly consider the role of museums, the role of critics, curators, dealers, scholars, and even artists in the consecration of art, like what can the defining what can count as art. Shortly before Hicks's appearance in the 2014 Whitney Biennial, a colleague of mine remarked that her newfound visibility in the contemporary art world was no surprise, as it seemed to fit the pattern of the revival of interest in the work of women artists in their later years, from Linda Benglis to Yoko Ono. That's only tip of the iceberg. I mean, there's many, many examples. Louise Bourgeois, Marilyn Minter. I mean, the list goes on and on. It's a version of that story about how the market comes back around to things that it once excluded that can, I think, be a little bit too simplistic. It seems logical enough in the case of Hicks, but except for the fact that her work was, until very recently, hardly known as opposed to just merely forgotten in the contemporary art world. By contrast, her work is renowned and admired within the fields of craft and design, where she has worked steadily since the 1960s. So the rush of attention that's coming from the contemporary art world, I think, is more accurately defined as a completely new audience, and by extension, a new market for her work. And I would argue that for this to happen, or to appear in a realm where traditional craft media has always been regarded with skepticism, if not outright disdain, there have to be additional forces beyond those behind the typical revival of a long-established but overlooked women artists. So to do that, let's dive into this arc that I mentioned. And I'm going to start out with Hicks's earliest public, let's say, exposure and installations, which took place in a variety of contexts, which is important to consider. She had small exhibitions in Knoll showrooms in Mexico City and Chicago. This is one example of a work here. So this is within a commercial design context. I'm showing you an image of her on the right-hand side preparing some works for an exhibition that she would have in Mexico City in a small gallery, and you can get a feel for the size and scale of the works that she was doing at that time. That's in around 1960-61. Her work entered the collection of the Museum of Modern Art in 1960, but, and this is important, in the Department of Architecture and Design, this is an example, this piece, Blue Letter, was collected by MoMA, the curator of architecture and design in 1960. And by the mid-60s, she was fulfilling commissions for large wall and room size installation at various corporate headquarters from the Ford Foundation to CBS's New York headquarters. You see her on the left-hand side here in this historic photo, putting the finishing touches on a wall for the Ford Foundation, which has now been completely restored. There's a wonderful video of it in the exhibition. And then this is a bad slide, but it is an installation of what you could find. It's a giant prayer rug that was originally installed at the CBS building in 1966 in the ground floor restaurant on 52nd Street. So from the get-go, I guess what I want to say is that her work was not confined to the gallery world. She was working in many different contexts, and this is interesting for her for that time period. In terms of museum exhibitions, there were two defining moments for Hicks in the late 60s. The first came in 67 when she was invited to exhibit in the prestigious International Tapestry Biennial in Lausanne, Switzerland, and this was a big deal. And she repeatedly participated in these tapestry biennials over the years. And I don't know the exact works that she brought to that original show, but this kind of gives you an idea. They were going to be big, and they were going to be hanging on the wall. So it's a good. The piece on the right is a Lion's Lair from '68 for the George Jensen Center for Advanced Design in New York. And this is a work from the late 60s on the left-hand side called Banyan. And her submission, which probably looks something like Banyan, caused an existential crisis within the organization. And Hicks talks about this, and it's very funny because if you have heard her voice, well, you have heard her voice if you've seen the videos, and it's very proper. She's extremely reflective and smart. So you can kind of get a feel for what she was up against and how she like dealt with it. She says, I showed something I had just made in Chile out of linen with clusters of long, free-handing cords suspended from the ceiling. This, remember, is a tapestry biennial. At the opening, a television crew arrived, led by a certain Madame Coutoli, a patron of tapestry and a fabulous character. She walked up to me and said in French, Mademoiselle, I hear you are exhibiting a tapestry. I replied, yes, Madame, here it is. And she said, I do not see a tapestry. And it became a running joke. What is tapestry and what is not? And it's true, Hicks kind of led the charge of completely dismantling the definition of what tapestry could be with works like this at this biennial. It was never the same. Hicks continued, I was moving around between different techniques of stitching, wrapping, braiding, weaving, twining, exploring all these different thread languages. So my work was equated with a kind of graffiti. For some, I was a persona non grata, and for others, I was the heroic pirate, end quote. In 1969, there's another break for her. She participated in an exhibition at MoMA called Wall Hangings. You see this piece here on the bottom left-hand side, and there's a color detail of it there. It's called The Evolving Tapestry from 67-68. This really further ensconced her within the avant-garde of the fiber movement. This was a groundbreaking exhibition. It was curated by Mildred Constantine from the Department of Architecture and Design. She was the one who was responsible for the acquisition I showed you, Blue Letter, earlier, as well as for a couple of the commissions that Sheila had in New York City. So Wall Hangings featured an international stable of artists whose work radically reconsidered weaving and thus the potential of fiber as a material of high art. And Constantine's intention was to bring this to the New York art world and legitimate it as a form of sculpture. Radical as it was, as a challenge to deep-rooted prejudices towards fiber's craft, Wall Hangings really only received a single review in the national art press. It was commissioned from the sculptor Louise Bourgeois for the magazine Craft Horizons. And Bourgeois' response to the works in the exhibition, which she argued, I'm quoting her here, rarely liberate themselves from decoration, end quote, illustrate what is sometimes referred to in academic circles of reception theory as a horizon or a structure of expectations that, in this case, members of the art world brought to works in fiber and by extension craft in this period. It was extremely limiting. It was very hard for them to imagine this material ever functioning in a higher art context. So central to this horizon of expectations was the understanding of the term decorative or decoration. It was a pejorative then, as it still can be today when it's applied to a work of art. And it situates a work of art as the opposite, really, of what we think of as fine art or high art. In an interview 10 years later, Bourgeois herself warned, I'm quoting her here, when you work in the school of abstraction, you have to avoid the decorative, end quote. So it demonstrates her familiarity with the category as like a threat to the identity and the critical purpose of art. So one of the questions I always have is, was it Constantine's institutional and professional associations with the field of design? Was it wall hanging's startling new approach to a medium that's historically dismissed as a feminine craft? Was it Bourgeois' own fear of her work being engulfed by the decorative? Or the intersection of all of these factors that resulted in her very lukewarm reception of this work? Maybe it was all of the above. Bourgeois' family history in the field of tapestry restoration, as well as her own work in this period, which is extremely haptic and had this sensual quality, some would argue a textile-like quality, actually should have made her a very interesting, potentially sympathetic critic. I'll show you. These are two works that from the 1960s. They're soft forms that have been dipped in resin. So they've hardened over time, but initially they would have been quite pliable. It was also work like this that appeared in exhibitions in New York City around the time of wall hangings that were really devoted to soft, malleable materials like fiber and plastic. This is an exhibition that Lucy Lepard produced in 1966 called Eccentric Abstraction. And Bourgeois' works were included here along with, you know, string constructions, pieces of cast rubber, plastic installations that inflated and deflated. It was all very soft and sensual. So again, there's this question of like, well, what could have, what's with the anxiety that Bourgeois expressed towards wall hanging and the new fiber art? In the end, she just concluded, you know, a painting or a sculpture makes great demands on the onlooker at the same time that it is independent of him. These weaves, she's talking about work from wall hangings, many of which were not woven, delightful as they are, seem more engaging and less demanding. If they must be classified, they would fall somewhere between fine and applied art, end quote. So that was the extent of her reception. Regardless of its lukewarm reception in the art world, wall hangings did in fact initiate a flurry of fiber-based exhibitions and books in the 70s and 80s across North America that participated in the creation of a fiber movement through really with a shared goal of legitimizing fiber as a medium of high art. And I'm just showing you a small assortment of the kinds of exhibitions that came out in that period. There was a lot of energy expended over the two decades, but the positive reception of this work outside this movement itself was limited, and the campaign kind of plateaued by the late 1980s. I argue elsewhere, and I'm just gonna, okay, shameless plug, this is the book that Alan mentioned, but I wanted to show this particular piece by Harmony Hammond, this dress-like form, next to a work by Miriam Shapiro, which is also about a form of dress, the kimono, as two additional examples of feminist work in fiber that was being produced in the 1970s. And in this book and elsewhere, I've argued that it really was the feminist elevation of craft in this period that which was a project to politicize in essence the hierarchy of art and craft. that really prove more successful at challenging the art world's prejudices against fiber than the efforts and supporters of the fiber movement. You can't have one without the other, as far as I'm concerned, but these artists made a tremendous impact. They, within the art world that they were working in, their work was more or less despised, so it's not like they found automatic success. It was, it sort of took time for the effect to make its way into the art world. But nevertheless, they did an excellent job at exposing the gender and racial politics behind the maintenance of this subordination of craft to art, as well as they had a related insistence that women's experience and artistic traditions were in fact legitimate subjects for art making, and that laid the foundation for fiber's acceptance as a fine art medium. Their objective was, in essence, to deflate the negative associations surrounding craft, and that played an important role that would become, by the early 1990s, an important feature of a changed art world in relation to this art, craft, and divide. And so we're going to jump to the 90s now. and this is where, after this kind of plateauing of all of these exhibitions related to fiber and fiber sculpture, interest in this medium picks up again and enters kind of a new chapter in the 1990s. I'm just showing you a very brief survey. This is just tip of the iceberg, but on the left-hand side, a work by Charles Ladre. He works in miniature. These are handmade miniature suits of clothing. On the bottom, something that comes quite close to a lot of the fiber-related work that was being made in the 60s and 70s. This is the installation artist Sheila Pepe. Above her, Gata Amer, and on the right-hand side, Kim Suja, Korean artist who's very interested in Korean textile traditions. You see here just three stills from a project about the name, I'm blanking on the name of the Korean tradition of wrapping with cloth, botari, that she repeatedly returns to in a lot of her work. Numerous artists could be illustrated here, but perhaps the most notable is our friend Louise Bourgeois. Because in 1990, she begins cutting up and sewing a lifetime of stored clothing, linens, and fabric remnants that she had been saving since she was probably a teenager. And she started to make a large body of new work consisting of stuffed heads, human figures, and then also reproductions of her slender stacked sculptures from the 1950s, which were originally made in wood. And then also unique fabric on fabric books. And here's an example of one of the books. And then I have another head and a page from a book there. So this turn to fiber in the 90s, especially in the case of Bourgeois, suggests that the boundary that once separated craft from art, presumably informing her earlier rejection of fiber-based work in 1969, basically all but disappeared in the art world. And indeed, the embrace of fiber bar artists in the 90s creates a picture of a significantly altered field. There's, in my opinion, there's three interconnected forces fueling the more hospitable environment for fiber and art that we can isolate and think about. The first, as I've mentioned briefly, concerns the feminist art movement's legitimation of women's everyday experience as a subject for art. Before that time, it really was considered inappropriate to use your personal experience as the content, the narrative content of your art. This gave artists permission to draw openly, not just from craft's aesthetic properties, but also its social and cultural meanings pertaining to gender. So in other words, work didn't have to just be abstract and self-referential. You could use a material like a string or a piece of yarn or embroidery, and it could reference to the viewer a range of different meanings that might connect to their own personal experience or their experience of the home or their grandmother, etc. The list could go on and on. So this is a move away from a formalist approach to materials, and it really resulted in an unprecedented expansion of artistic form and practice that we appreciate today. And related to this expansion, there was the rise of installation art in the 1990s. I mean, we take it for granted that it's been around forever, but it really hasn't. And that's a genre, like feminist art, that allowed artists to create scenarios that you then, narratives that you then enter, room size, total works of art, that also drew on what generally people will call the extra aesthetic associations in the production of meaning. So a piece of cloth and an insulation which is sitting next to some other object, you immediately start to make connections and you're building up narratives in ways that really very different experience that you're having with art objects once insulation comes on the scene. So related to this expansion, Bourgeois actually had a lot to say about it. And about her fiber-based work as expressing some of the most time-honored extra aesthetic associations connected to the medium, especially its connection to history and memory. And I'm going to quote her here. She says, "With these works, I want to re-experience the past. I want to try to reconstruct it." So she's using fiber to do that. And regarding the fabric books, she's explained that, quote, "They are about the idea of restoration, reconciliation, of holding things together in the face of fear of disintegration." And of course, she was an old woman at that point, facing the end of her life. Finally, there's another factor that has to be taken under consideration. Amongst curators of contemporary art in the 90s and into the present, the relevance of like preoccupations, what we would call modernist preoccupations with hierarchies and boundaries between painting, sculpture, craft, and art, that historically categorized craft medium or craft materials as like non-art or kitsch or mere decoration, they really began to wane. And I'm going to quote from a very prominent U.S.-based Nigerian critic and curator, Okwi Enweser, about this. He says, "In the 1990s, contemporary art took an entirely new direction as a coalescing of post-colonialism and globalization changed the principles under which curatorial practice advanced artistic and critical analyses of aesthetic and cultural canons." I'll summarize this, don't worry. There was a shift in curatorial language from one whose reference systems belonged to an early 20th century modernity to one more attuned to the tendencies of the 21st century. So, you know, what is he saying? Basically, his point is that the contemporary art world, as it globalizes and diversifies, and this begins to happen in the 90s, entrenched ideologies over what counts as art begin to wane and start to look very provincial. So what is the center of the discourse begins to look like a peripheral position. So a good example of this would be the hierarchy of art and craft and the dismissal of craft as a lesser aesthetic value. Policing the boundaries between those two things suddenly doesn't feel as compelling anymore or as an important position. So going back to reception theory, like the horizon of expectations begins to loosen and destabilize and open up. I don't think Enweser is interested in the art-craft divide at all, but it is something that fits within his description here when he says, "We've shifted away from reference systems that belong to the early 20th century." I mean, essentially that entrenched belief that there's a difference between art and craft and that you need to police those boundaries was, originated in that period. He's just generally referring to the history of modernism, which of course excluded craft media from the canon. And just to put it in more concrete terms by looking at artists, someone like Yinka Shonabari, the British artist, is a good example. I'm showing you on the left here a piece that has to do with the colonial partitioning of Africa by European powers. They're sitting around a table with a map of Africa, but they're wearing a sort of what the so-called Dutch wax resist cloth, which we associate with parts of West Africa. And on the right-hand side is a comparative example of someone wearing these very vibrant cloths. All of his work uses that cloth to talk about issues of race and power and identity. Another good example is the work of Nick Cave. I'm showing you on the left one of his sound suits. So these are fibrous suits that when you wear them and perform in them have organic sound to them. On the right-hand side, you see the artist working on the surface of a large piece. And I just want to point out that the tradition he's drawing from has to do with carnival and Mardi Gras. These are experiences or aesthetic practices that were far, far outside what was considered proper to modernism. Nowadays, of course, incorporated into the contemporary art world. So it's a great example of these reference systems like falling apart from the early 20th century. Okay, so back to Hicks here. This changed cultural context created by these factors is really essential for understanding Hicks' expanded reception and her new market in the contemporary art world. But it still took actions of various art world actors from different, very different professional spheres to create the increase in recognition that she enjoys today outside of craft and design circles. Just showing you four examples of her small weavings. There are many in the exhibition, which I know you've seen. So this new level of recognition begins, for me, with a particular body of work, these works, a book, and an exhibition. And together, I see this like constellation of objects and events and actors behind them, redirecting Hicks's work away from the world of textile and design into a much more high profile and still, unfortunately, more valued world of contemporary art. So the body of works in question is the more than 1,000 miniature weavings that Hicks has produced over the course of her career as visual recordings of her travels, formal experiments with color, texture, form, and preliminary notes for large-scale commissions. This is an installation shot of them here. Some 150 of these works were exhibited in 2006 for the first time at the Bard Graduate Center Gallery. And this was an institution that's dedicated to, like the Bard Graduate Center itself, to the history of material culture, design, and the decorative arts. The exhibition was the first to bring the miniatures together as a critical mass, but based on my casual, I will admit, totally unscientific conversations with colleagues in the contemporary art world, it was the exhibition's catalog called Sheila Hicks, Weaving as Metaphor, or more specifically, its exquisite design, it really is an artwork in and of itself, that captured their attention. They didn't know who Sheila Hicks was. This was a book that was designed by Irma Boom, the well-known Dutch graphic designer. The book's dimensions, it's about 6 by 8 inches, mirrors the scale of Hicks's miniature weavings, and they're reproduced in the book. Very, very beautiful texture and color. Its intimate size was complemented by a soft rag paper, which also produced a rich haptic quality that psychologically and culturally associated these works with the handmade. And then I would also argue that its chromatic white cover and this very eye-catching serrated decal edge was mentioned over and over and over to me by my colleagues as the feature that led them to pick up the book in the first place. Like the name Sheila Hicks, no recognition, but they saw that book and they picked it up. So it too visually relates to seemingly casual yet artful quality of the weavings inside. It made a persuasive case for them, for this particular audience. A year after its publication, months after the first edition had sold out, the book won a gold medal at the 2007 Leipzig Book Fair for, quote unquote, the most beautiful book in the world, which is like the greatest award I think probably exists out there. Joan Simon, an independent curator and contributing author to the book Weaving as Metaphor, went on to co-curate the artist's amazingly first retrospective, which opened at the Addison Gallery of American Art at Phillips Academy in 2011. And the exhibition and its accompanying catalog, Sheila Hicks 50 Years, provided the first overview of the artist's large-scale work designed to reach a broad art audience. So they're introduced through the small miniature weavings, and then there's suddenly a publication that allows you to see the whole career. That exhibition continued to the ICA Philadelphia. I'm showing you it here. And that was very crucial to Hicks's exposure and quote-unquote discovery within elite circles of the contemporary art world, totally unaware that such work existed, let alone had been produced as early as the mid-1960s. From what I can tell, I mean, I'd have to really think about this, but my gut reaction to it was like, wow, I think this is the first time I've seen anything in a museum called Institute of Contemporary Art dedicated to the most cutting edge current that was focused on craft history. So the show was brought to the ICA Philadelphia by a curator named Janelle Porter, and she encountered Hicks's work through the book Weaving as Metaphor. She's an interesting curator and has no regard for the baggage that usually surrounds the contemporary art world's skepticism towards craft. She's a good example of this waning relevance of modernist, you know, theoretical preoccupations over the art-craft divide, at least in some curatorial circles. So Hicks's Bard exhibition was reviewed almost exclusively within pages of journals and magazines devoted to the field of fiber, like fiber arts and textiles. But her retrospective, this show, made the pages of Art Forum, Art News, and the New York Times. And that's a difference between what the change that can happen when you're suddenly in an institution that's perceived as a center of the art world, an ICA or an MCA. It was positively assessed for its relationship to post-minimalist approaches to materials and process, and also the artist's, quote, omnivorous curiosity and allergy to academic distinctions. So they're even picking up on her own personal ethos and an approach as an artist. So we've looked at briefly the role of curators, critics, art historians, and one graphic designer in the creation of this new visibility for Hicks. I would also say that young contemporary artists also played an important role in this new formation, and they continue to do that. And the case of Hicks really does provide a rare opportunity to consider the importance that artists themselves play in the reception of their peers or elders within the contemporary art world. And they're often talked about as people who have no power in the art world. I think this is a great example of how that's just not the case. For Hicks, the first opportunity came in the form of a group show called Come Through, and I'm showing you a couple installation shots here, that opened in the summer of 2009 at Sycamore Jenkins, which was the gallery that will, 2 years later, pick up Hicks as a part of their roster. It's a very high-profile gallery in the Chelsea district, so it's a powerhouse. The show was curated by artists Fabienne Lasserre and Molly Smith and included the works of Hicks, Ree Morton, Jessica Dixon, Siobhan Liddell, and Emily Doe, all very young, with the exception of Ree Morton, who's would have been the same generation of Hicks. Smith graduated, one of the curators, in 1999 from the Rhode Island School of Design. That's an institution with artists on the faculty who work in fiber and textiles, and she had been exposed to Hicks' work as a student there, so that's very important. She's coming out of a place that has an openness towards this history of fiber art. And it was she that introduced Hicks to her co-curator. And they explained to me that Hicks's work, I'm quoting them here, reflects a lifelong practice of flexibility and cross-disciplinarity, a characteristic of her career that worked against her in the art world when she came up in it, but is now very attractive to us, a younger generation of artists much more comfortable with hybridity and open about working between and across disciplines, categories, and fields, even if the art market has yet to fully embrace it. They believe that her work, I'm quoting them again here, operates on and between the edges of various disciplines and stretches these categories. One of them continues, the work of Sheila Hicks toys with the decorative, the domestic, and fantasy, all too often considered easy, backwards, regressive, and make radical strides in form and format. The materials she uses feel close to home and familiar, yet the results are complex, sophisticated, and disconcerting. That play with the familiar, that prosaic use of material is important to us. For Molly and I, Hicks offered a very different definition of success as an artist than the one prevailing in today's market-driven art world. Her practice seems flexible and self-generating as much as an outlook on life as on art. Checking my time here. So I'm going to skip ahead a little bit and talk about, just to summarize that, they've got this interest in process, everyday materials, personal content, artistic practice as a form of lifestyle. That's a dramatic change from the world that Sheila Hicks came up in, and it has to do with this huge expansion of what can count as art and what the content can be and how it can relate to your everyday life. Okay, and now, let me see. Oh, and then I'll just quote one other person here, Allison Gingeross, another curator. She says, her work has mostly been received and absorbed into a craft and design world, but so much of it speaks to what younger artists are thinking about now. If the work included in Come Through is any indication, one thing on their minds is the innovative use of humble materials that flouts historical prescriptions, defining the high and the low in art and culture. I'm going to skip through here. I mentioned that Sycamore Jenkins, of course, picked up Sheila 2 years later after that exhibition, so that clearly had an effect. And since then, her career has really just exploded. In 2014, as I mentioned earlier, she participated in the Whitney Biennial, and I'm going to close with that because this particular biennial was divided into three floors, and there were three individually organized exhibitions. She was included in the section organized by the artist Michelle Grabner, an artist of painting, a professor of painting at the School of the Art Institute of Chicago. Grabner's painting practice is inspired by the repetitive patterns found throughout our everyday world, from the handmade crochet of the Afghan to the simple plain weave of the dish towel. So she already shares an affinity with textile and craft cultures, as well as associations to the domestic sphere and the decorative. So she's strongly identifies with a lot of the same things that these younger artists are talking about. She was included alongside a lot of others that Grabner says has been fundamentally important to me as an artist over the years. And so you can see an installation shot. That's a different show, this one here. She's mixed in with artists working large-scale ceramics. There's installations with other fiber-based work. And so it's a very interesting cross-disciplinary bringing together of work that almost never shares the same stage, at least in New York City. And it does show how an artist can start and shape a conversation about what can count as art today that crosses many, many disciplinary boundaries in ways that are normally a little bit unorthodox. And so she fostered a dynamic discussion in which Sheila could be part of. Okay, I'm just gonna close by saying that the Pillar of Inquiry supple column was acquired by MoMA after the show for the Modern and Contemporary collection, whereas of course the previously the museum's acquisitions of her work went into the Department of Design and Architecture. And so both departments continue to collect her work. I'll show you, ribbons is a good example of something that was just recently collected by the Department of Design and Architecture. That's on your left, the Pillar of Inquiry on your right. And it gives, you know, these acquisitions really demonstrate how Hicks uniquely bridges the art-craft divide without ever having to give up one position for the other. And this really was a privilege that was not available to her or her fiber art peers in the 60s and 70s, but it is a much more accurate picture of artistic practice today. In an interview on the occasion of her inclusion in the Whitney Biennial, Hicks brilliantly turns the table on this whole issue of hierarchy and exclusion in the art world by making the center, in this case the contemporary art world to which she refers as a cloistered realm of practice, look more like the periphery. In an interview, when asked how and why she resisted changing her practice to better fit the contemporary art market over the past 50 years, Hicks answered, "Well, I haven't been in the contemporary art world, and a way of not being in it was to blow that scene. Don't forget, I've been working in the trenches, not in the art milieu. I've been working in factories, design offices, on architectural projects. I haven't been cloistered in the so-called art world with its terminology and its hierarchies." The interviewer goes on, quote, "And as much as you haven't been cloistered, have you felt excluded?" End quote. In her characteristically witty style of rejoinder that deflects the politics behind what I have addressed as the hard-won respect for fiber and art over the past 50 years, Hicks answers, quote, "I have always been pleasantly surprised when included," end quote. So I'll just end there. Thank you.
So that then we'll be
All right. Welcome back, everybody. Thank you for keeping that that short. It's now my pleasure to introduce to you Sarah Zapata. Sarah is a textile artist and writer from Corpus Christi, Texas, originally, and now based in Brooklyn, New York. She's Peruvian American, and her practice revolves around how the techniques of traditional work by women from the United States and Peru can be used in bombastic ways to create contemporary art. Sarah has exhibited with Red Bull Studios in New York City, El Museo del Barrio in New York as well, Lax Art in Hollywood, California, and the New Museum also in New York. She was recently artist in residence at the Museum of Arts and Design and at the Massachusetts Museum of Contemporary Art. Sarah is currently working on an exhibition, a solo exhibition, which will take place later this year at the Delhi Gallery in Long Island City, New York. This exhibition was made possible through a grant from the National Association of Latino Arts and Culture. All right, Sarah.
Okay, hello. My name is Sarah Zapata, and I am an artist and writer based in New York. Through investigating my own cultural heritage, my practice has become an amalgamation of different traditional crafts practiced by women from the United States and Peru. I approach my practice with gender and cultural performativity in mind, how traditional craft techniques practiced by women in the United States and Peru can be used in bombastic capacities. I utilize the hard and soft qualities of textiles by exploring an array of techniques to make contemporary work. I am interested in thinking about textiles as architectural components used to build three-dimensional forms and environments. So I'm going to start with this video that was made for this event last November that was held at the New Museum in New York. It was organized, it was organized by four collectives. One was called Bias for Us, a decentralized multimedia documentary project focusing on the discourse of Black and Asian cultural and political relationships. Dis Woman, which is a New York-based platform, collective, and booking agency representing and showcasing cis women, trans women, and genderqueer. House of Ladosha, which is a collective exploring the house philosophy popularized by ballroom culture. And Brujas, a free-form, urban revolutionary feminist collective that expresses community through skateboarding and political organizing. As part of the education department, Scamming the Patriarchy hosted a youth summit and celebration organized by an emerging generation of artists, writers, and activists. The summit included numerous workshops organized around five guiding principles: healing, self-love, skill building, political education, and empowerment. The programming looked to the future of gender politics, focusing on methods for forging the world's youth want to inhabit, while grounding this work in legacies of the past. Programming centered on confronting inequality and injustice, supporting spiritual and economic sustainability, and cultivating a space to turn up with women, femmes, the dolls, and all queer kinfolk at the forefront. So for the Youth Summit, I held a yarn workshop where participants were given materials and taught the technique of coiling. Coiling is a basketry technique that I use quite frequently. It is present in many different cultures and traditionally used for water vessels for its tight structure. I am continuously interested in the accessibility of traditional women's work techniques and how these processes can be used in radical ways. This particular technique can be used in many different capacities and uses only yarn, rope, and a tapestry needle. An instructional video was made to be projected during the workshop as I worked with participants. This event became particularly poignant as it occurred a few days after the election. I aim to promote the continuation of traditional craft techniques, and it felt empowering to work with high school youth of New York City that were excited to work with their hands and to be dexterous in a completely different way from the overbearing swipe. This video was shot in my studio on VHS using my rugs to create a solitary, dreamlike environment to work with the technique. I wanted it to feel luxurious and over the top to emphasize that these traditional conventions can be used in whatever capacity you can imagine. I like to think about humans having a textile fetish and how this obsession can change one's perception of how the body interacts with hard and soft aspects of cloth. As our world moves towards the illusory and becomes and what becomes of our sense of space and connection to history. Materials, textiles, images, and video are still a part of our surface society. They allow us to interact within a social reality, a reality that is not inclusive, but maybe not totally aware of its physical surroundings anymore. With my work, I'm interested in examining this awareness and a push for a connection between the material, the social, and the historical context. I'm curious of my position in society, the power that I harness as a woman. My materials are common, yarn, ubiquitous objects, fabrics, paper, the kitchen sink. Their value is not inherent, perhaps engendered, a testament to time. As a woman employing traditional craft techniques, I appropriate value within processes and objects. By making work with meditative mechanical means and a symbiotic practice of writing, I produce pieces that are time-consuming and labor-intensive, dealing with imagery of the feminine, the fetishized, the handmade, the punchline. Feet are a common symbol that I use to talk about sexuality and objectification. I use feet as a common thread through my physical work and writing to explore how the body can activate textiles in an engaging manner, but also as a reconfiguration of shame associated with my strict evangelical Christian upbringing. I'm going to read an excerpt of a piece that was commissioned for a reading titled Mounting Frustration. Are there any words left to describe how unjust this all is? This reading tackled collective and individual discontent as people of color during the last twilight of the West. And later this year, Blonde Art Books will be publishing an edition of this text. Vendors slither down the pavement with melted helado, tilted chins exhaling heat onto gold-dipped chains and button blouses. There is a hole in my brown sock at the tip on the left. The neck of my right hallux is being inhibited, its circulation starting to be cut off. The day's heat and my own aggression are being funneled into this toe, the most human part of my body. The big toe is the most differentiated part of a human from a chimpanzee, gorilla, gibbon, or ape. These toes show that we are erect. We are not tree dwelling. We do not need two sets of hands. This is the toe, the big toe, a sign that I stand vertically on these two flat planes, that I change my underwear every few days. Dogs paddle down the block, tongues unfurled and wiggling to the ground. The afternoon was thick. I was twisting in my socks as I walked down the street, gazing at store windows. My steps held fast to the path of martini-colored sidewalk, newspaper-clean windows full of plastic asses, acrylic inserts holding sandals cocked. Miles of highlighter-colored knits with variations of straight out of bed, straight out of money, straight out of church. Garments so curiously uninvolved in the original conception, only something else to consume. Fast fashion as empowerment, feet that run rapidly towards distraction. Straight out of shape, straight out of cheer practice, straight out of mommy. My feet have not slipped. The hallux is the anchor, but the long toe is pure elegance. I have an extended second toe, Morton's toe or Greek foot, an ideal aesthetic for feet in ancient Greek sculpture and onward. The Statue of Liberty has this proportion of a longer second toe, an ancestral foot. How beautiful are the feet of those who bring good news of good things. Morton's toe is an atavism, an evolutionary shift backward to feet more reminiscent of simian brothers. These two toes argue over time, the hallux dwelling in the future outside of my sock. My big toe pulses, The thin cotton strands delicately unravel. My toe perspires, adding oil to the friction. But I find no resting place for the sole of my foot amongst the dogs and banana peels. So I look for my arc, shake the dust off my feet. A woman in black security sneakers, foiled plastic badge, and laminated identification clipped to her hip belt loop stands by the entrance. She recognizes my gait. Though my feet are dressed, she can smell my exhausted big toe. She extends her knee above her ankle and shifts her weight to the center of her swollen heel. I was born in Corpus Christi. My mother was a blonde Texan who was an opera singer turned piano and vocal teacher. My father was a chemical engineer originally from Peru. We moved to a suburb of Dallas, where my interest in history began. Dallas is a complicated place that has little appreciation for its past. It is a city where the president was assassinated. It is still largely segregated, and it is full of stucco, ageless buildings. Early on, I witnessed my own brother say that if he could, he would bleed every drop of Hispanic blood out of his body, but went on to accept a scholarship from a Latino academic organization. I was very aware of the differences of each side of my family. It became a source of pride and confusion. It is a priority for me to honor both heritages in my work, not only when it is advantageous or convenient, but as consistent maintain respect as an American and a Latina. The foot occurs in many idioms expressing human relationships or situations. It is a common archetype in the Bible to talk about your relationship to the divine and a testament to your trajectory through life. When I began thinking about the relationship of textiles and feet, I made my first rug installation, Thin Thread. This installation was a lush, sensuously enhanced environment to film the interaction of viewers. My studio transformed into a tactile scene where participants were asked to explore, feel, and play however they so chose. Covering about 100 square feet, a sprawling shag rug with paper sculptures housed four security cameras. In the post 9/11 era, we live within an age of uninhibited and overt surveillance. Footage is compiled as metadata, kept for 5 years at minimum, and by and large, individuals are not able to access their own information. As more data is collected, the portrait of an individual becomes more clear than an image or video captured. Thin Thread is the name of the program for the National Security Agency that was developed by William Benny, a former ranking intelligence officer turned whistleblower. The program was a data collection system that kept the information of Americans anonymous, collecting only unidentifiable content. The program was scrapped, and instead the government uses a program that collects metadata associated with identity. The installation was made in homage to Franz West, using colors and shapes from his series of Pashtuk, objects with the sole intention of provoking physical response. Participants entered the space barefoot, which perhaps left some individuals uncomfortable, turned on, or unfazed by the nakedness of one's feet. The actions of the participants were captured via their feet through the cameras pointed at downward angles. The footage collected from Thin Thread was made into a foot porn of sorts to talk about authorship and intention. While the privacy of the visitors will remain protected, they will have no control of what's done with the footage. How is the value of my objects obtuse as a woman? My present is reclaiming this control, preserving relevance. Rosika Parker explains in The Subversive Stitch, in the Victorian Revival, women practicing needlecraft often depicted biblical allegories. One of the most common was St. Margaret. St. Margaret was a chaste woman, but there was a town elder that pursued her for his wife. She continued to decline and was then thrown in jail for her loyalty to God. There, while in prison, the devil came to her in the form of a dragon, where she made the sign of the cross with her arms as the dragon consumed her. She burst out of his body in the shape of the crucifix and then became the patron saint of childbirth. This narrative inspired me in thinking about the female body as a controlled vessel. I worked on these coiled sculptures that were within the confines of being a basket, but utilized different elements of value systems. The titles of No Nonsense in an Older Goddess Tradition, Apocryphal and Not to be Taken Seriously, and Reflecting the Pagan Divinity Aphrodite are all lines from the Wikipedia page of St. Margaret, who surprisingly has very little information available online. These sculptures have a commonality of the expense of time. Prosthetic feet and hands originally used for individuals working on their aesthetician license are used to allude to the art of beauty, while the socks were purchased off an eBay category called well-worn, a still active fetish category quieter in the sect of the auction website. Sellers use this site of eBay to create narratives for used stockings and socks that sell for as much as $1,000 for a single pair of pantyhose. And so you can, and this is also an example of coiling. So this particular sculpture is about 5 feet tall. And so it's, again, you can see how much control you have with this technique. It's just sewing rope on top of itself. I originally began an interest in weaving because my father is from Peru and my grandfather a textile salesman back in Piura. As Sadie Plant explains in The Future Looms, Weaving Women and Cybernetics, for Freud, weaving imitates the concealment of the womb. Weaving is a woman's compensation for the absence of the penis, the void of the woman of whom, as he famously insists, there is nothing to be seen. Woman is veiled, she weaves to sustain the disavowal of her sex. Hand weaving is said to be the quintessence of women's work, but it has incredibly rigid connotations. Many times weaving is confined to right angles, but I'm interested in completely disregarding these conventions. Weaving is my language for being a woman. I embrace its convention and parameters. I'm interested in reclaiming weaving and other women's work to be valuable, erotic, ridiculous, not a vapid activity practiced by the thoughtless. I received a grant from the Surface Design Association to study tapestry techniques in Peru. I spent a total of 2 months there, traveling from Lima, Cusco, Arequipa, the Cauca Valley, Moncura, Catacaos, and Piura. I spent most of my time learning different weaving techniques, but spent the last remaining weeks with my family in the north. I was very inspired by Peruvian arpilleras that I saw at the Museum of Art in Lima. While there, an election was going on for different regional and municipal districts. In the run-up to the elections, dozens of candidates had been accused of involvement in criminal activities ranging from corruption to terrorism and even rape. Each candidate had a pictorial image for the ballot, each appealing to different voters' sense of ethos. One candidate had a chicken playing with a soccer ball, another a bell pepper with a smile, another with a cow and a halo. One image stuck in my mind. It was a very simple line drawing of a mother holding a baby, everyone smiling. So after I came back from Peru, I began working on a commission for El Museo del Barrio. I really wanted to work with the contrast of cultures that I experience, so I returned to look more at American hooked rugs. Rug hooking has its origin in the early 19th century, where workers in weaving mills were allowed to take home pieces of 9-inch long yarn called thrums, which were useless to the mill. The workers used the thrums to pull loops through a coarse backing to make a homemade rug. This was the closest impoverished families got to owning a carpet. The craft owes its existence to impoverished folks who could only dream of owning the expensive carpets that adorned the homes of the rich. When factory-made carpets became all the rage in America after they were introduced sometime after 1830, poor women who couldn't afford them began making their own. The result was hooked rugs, an imitation that was shunned from the wealthy class at the time, very much like arpilleras, which are also made from scraps. They're these incredible quilted pieces that were made in Peru and Chile. So I wanted to work with these two inspirations for this piece, which were, the colors were very much inspired by when I was in Peru, but just also over the top craft colors. The colors and materials are overly feminine to edify on the idea of what a woman should be, a mother, a beauty. There are toes with long nails on the piece to emphasize my own kind of fetish and abstract narrative. The toes are made with all hand-woven fabric, and the fingernails are the only industrial fabric that was used. On the nails, I got the drawing reproduced in rhinestone to transfer onto the nails of the piece. The rhinestone drawing of the woman is the central relief. She is exalted in being the only formal depiction. I wanted the color and texture of the whole piece to function as a sort of cognitive mapping for the viewer, the hand being overly present in this process of storytelling through weaving, cutting, and sewing. It was named Siempre X as a reference to the text of the original political sign, but also thinking about what a woman always should be, the X being the placeholder for the adjective. While in residence at the artist studios at the Museum of Art and Design in New York, I proposed to work off the same idea as I explored in Siempre X at El Museo del Barrio, but in a sculptural manner. The residency is the only public residency program in New York where visitors to the museum come and talk to you in your studio as you work. And taking advantage of this setting of the residency, the work extended to a performative nature where viewers could access the slow meditative work in a new way. Engaging with participants and their relationship to textiles gave new narrative to these historically community-based works. While at the artist studios, MAD curator Samantha DeTilio and Elisa Author approached me to make an installation at the Marimekko flagship window for New York Textile Month. It was a challenge to work on such a labor-intensive installation. The wall panels and rugs are machine-sewn line by line as the center sculpture incorporated hand-woven fabric and mostly latch-hooked rugs. The installation gave me the opportunity to explore this new work not only sculpturally, but narratively by creating an environment. So now I'm working on a solo show that opens this spring at Delhi Gallery in Long Island City. Named after the 1970 Simon and Garfunkel song, El Candor Pasa, If I Could, the exhibition is a tactile embodiment of gender and cultural performativity. The song uses a Peruvian march, El Candor Pasa, and talks about humility and self-assurance. I'm very interested in expressing humility as I invoke these two precious cultures, but also in pushing myself to limits as to what I physically can do. My work is excessive, not to be arrogant, but to be earnest in my labor and neurosis. This exhibition also creates a platform for engaging viewers in a larger conversation about historical identity and how to reclaim this construct. The exhibition will engage viewers to think about the relevancy of women's work in relation to gender and culture, how craft is continued to be practiced. My practice preserves tradition and how historical handcrafts can be relevant in our lives today in the 21st century. Funded in part by a project grant by the National Association of Latino Arts and Culture, the exhibition will be comprised of a large rug that covers the entire 450 square foot space of the gallery, and there will be 7 negative spaces in the rug. In the negative spaces, there will be sculptures coming out of the ground, this relationship referencing the protuberances of limbs in the human body. The sculptures are made inspired by the Paracas mummy bundles, which the Paracas culture was this pre-Incan, pre-Columbian culture where they would bury their dead in a natal position, and they were housed in these really incredible baskets and then wrapped in all these really beautiful hand-woven textiles. So the sculptures will have a coiled base that builds up to house the sorts of these cross structures that will bear the weight of the woven fabrics. These vessels will be wrapped with hand-woven fabrics to the point that the crosses are not seen from the exterior. I'm thinking about these enacted practices maintaining the integrity of these handcrafts. When visitors come to the exhibition, they will be instructed to remove their shoes before entering the gallery. This pageantry will contribute to the experience of a new space and mindset, but also change how the individual is able to interact with the textile work. And thank you so much.
All right, well, first of all, thank you to both of the presenters for their talks this evening. As I was preparing for tonight's talk, I was thinking about an essay that I had contributed in 1996 to a catalog celebrating the 20th anniversary of the Sadie Bronfman Award. The catalog was called Transformation. The essay looked back to Octavio Paz's contribution to the World Crafts Council's publication In Praise of Hands. In Praise of Hands was published in conjunction with the first World Craft Exhibition, which was presented here in Toronto at the Ontario Science Centre in the summer of 1974. Over 500 works of craft were brought together from more than 50 countries. The range of artworks on display varied greatly. According to James Plaut, then the secretary of the World Crafts Council, the unifying element was that all the makers had produced works with their hands. And he put "with their hands" in italics. Rather than being shown in a gallery or a museum, In Praise of Hands was shown in the common areas of the Science Center. In the essay that Paz wrote, he differentiates craft from art or industrial design, saying, quote, "The craft object preserves fingerprints, be they real or metaphorical, of the artisan who fashioned it. These imprints are not the signature of the artist, they are not a name, nor are they a trademark. Rather, they are a sign, the scarcely visible, faded scar being made by human hands. The craft object is made by human hands. We cannot only see it, but caress it with our fingers." Now, Paz's essay was written at a time when craft traditions, I think, were being revitalized, really by a youth movement, and I think it's important to say that they were young people, and it was a movement really back to the earth. People were interested in works made from natural materials, like wood, clay, and fiber, and interested in reviving techniques that had become marginalized because of industrializations. Craft organizations were being strengthened, and the number of craftspeople was increasing greatly. Craft fairs took place all across the country, and in great part, we are still living with this conception of craft, an idea that posits craft in opposition to art and design. Elise's presentation addressed contemporaneous discussions that were taking place in other parts of the world, based on the taxonomies that we think are disappearing, but certainly are lessening today. Sarah's presentation addressed, among other things, the continuance of traditions as well as gender roles. Working in a large institution like the Canadian Museum of History, I'd like to begin our conversation by talking about the nature of museums. The writer Carol Duncan described two types of museums, the educational museum and the aesthetic museum. The Royal Ontario Museum would be an example of an educational museum, an organization interested in addressing topics of interest to a broad audience and quite populist. The Art Gallery of Ontario might be an example of an aesthetic museum interested in exhibiting works that require time and consideration and highlight very often the work of individual artists. This type of museum is also more elitist. Duncan claimed that both types of institutions were important to society. Since the time of her writing, I think a plethora of different types of institutions have been founded, and some, like the Textile Museum here, straddle both camps. In describing the place for craft in Paz's essay, he claims that, quote, "The destiny of the work of art is the air-conditioned eternity of the museum. The destiny of the industrial object is the trash barrel. The handcrafted object ordinarily escapes the museum and its glass display cases. And when it does happen to end up in one, it acquits itself honorably. It is a captive example, not an idol." My questions to Elisa and Sarah to start would be about the nature of the institutions interested in textile activity, and how have these institutions impacted the place of craft in museology and in the minds of the public. Does Duncan's dichotomy still hold true?
Oh my gosh. Where to start? Because there's a lot of different questions there. But let me just go to the Duncan, because you ended with Duncan and her distinction between the Museum of Education versus, what was the other one? The Aesthetic Institution, yeah. I, To a certain extent, I think that dichotomy still holds, if only because the discipline of art history, and I'm making a generalization here, art history has changed. That it's much more a diverse set of methodologies that are important to the field now than ever. But if you had to reduce it to something, you would say that art historical methodology is about making value judgments, right, between good and bad. And historically, that's what it was about, connoisseurship, et cetera. And the museum, the aesthetic museum, of course, internalized that. That's part of its ethos, right? Like, curatorial authority is about making decisions regarding the best work that you want to expose to the public or you want to exhibit. So it's very rooted in making distinctions of value, still is. And educational museums are still rooted in, you know, ethnography or looking at material culture broadly and telling stories about making in human lives. And they're still very different places. Although I would say there's a lot of the discussions surrounding what the missions of those different museums should be is alive and well, and they are changing. Mm-hmm.
Sure. I think I agree with what Elisa was saying, but I also think we're in such a strange transitional time right now where in my mind, I feel like there's also a big distinction between like digital art and net art and how now paintings or sculpture, are they becoming antiquated? Are they becoming like craft? And so I think it's as we approach these new mediums, no one's really knowing how to handle it.
Other part of the question that you started out related to, like, what do these institutions do with craft today? Yeah, and I know, you know, for a place like MAD, and well, I'll just speak about MAD, and as the collections curator, I've had to think about this a lot. Like, okay, so what should, how are we going to reactivate our permanent collection? That was something that I wanted to take on. And one of the ideas is like, well, if you're interested in the future of craft, which I think that institution is, then you want to make an argument for the historic work in your collection and its continuity with practice today, right? So one of the ways you can do this, and Sarah has been a part of it, is to have open studios where you have artists working in what we generally think of as historically craft materials in a very contemporary way. But then we also might have an artist, like right now, another really well-known fiber artist, Francois Grosin, who was part of the early fiber movement, was invited to show her works from the permanent collection alongside a group of works that she selected from the permanent collection. So again, it shows you're trying to show a continuous narrative, even though what contemporary work like Sarah's looks like might be extremely different, you know, from the historic work. It seems important to me to try to create connections the best that you can.
I think that there is a, I guess, a fairly new type of exhibition that is being developed, and that is when artists come into the more traditional museums and go through the collections. I know the Royal Ontario Museum has done it, and you know, a number of institutions have done it, and you know, can create juxtapositions, connections. Does this the type of approaches though? Can be quite different. Mm-hmm. So when they go into the collections and pick ethnographic materials, perhaps, it can be quite different, I think, than the approach of the contemporary artist, who can be, you know, sort of referencing those traditions, mm-hmm. but is moving in a different direction. Could you talk about that and maybe some examples, maybe? You
know? Sure. I mean, I can just say that it doesn't always make the audience happy. Right, because you also have audience members who are very invested in the the differences between art and craft, even though that might not be a discussion that I necessarily want to have or think that's relevant anymore. A lot of people, you know, there are audiences that think that it's very important that you preserve something about craft, and therefore to try to show some connection between past and present is not always satisfying for them, because they would prefer to see a continuation of that historic work in the very, very close replication, right, of that tradition. So it's not easy, it's not always successful, but it does make craft more relevant to a broader group of people interested in contemporary art. And so it is a kind of repositioning on some level as well. And so there's, it works for some audiences, and then others, it can be extremely demoralizing on some level.
I agree. I think the strongest shows that I feel like I see are ones that are based around ideas. And I think when you bring up like ethnographies, that can be represented in so many different ways. But when you take a show like the one that you brought up of Sinkuma Jenkins, where Sheila was in the four-person show, what was so strong about it is that there was such a broad range, but a lot of the same kind of ideas and concepts. And I think that we need to start like understanding art as within these like very strict confines, when it's much more about ideas, and that's not always beautiful, it's not always challenging, but that's what's sometimes the most important.
So where should we be exhibiting textile art? I mean, Lisa, you talked about the Whitney Museum and the importance of the biennial exhibition in Sheila's career. So is it important then that one sort of removes the textiles from the educational museum and goes to the aesthetic?
Sure. I mean, I think you can just, you can exhibit it anywhere at this point. It's a wide open field, and certainly contemporary artists, there are many contemporary artists who come to textiles and fibers without any background in fiber art or MFAs and, you know, textiles or anything like that. And so their interests are very different, and therefore the work looks quite different, and they are addressing audiences that might not, or in ways that might not appeal to like the same audience that maybe comes to MAD and is looking for traditional mid-century craft, or maybe even comes here, right? But there's also a place for textiles in history museums. It's because they tell different stories within that context. Yeah, so I wouldn't say that there's like a time for closing down MAD or a time for leaving the textile museum behind. Because they also are institutions with audiences and their own symposia and their own magazines. I mean, it'd be very hard to dismantle that, even though we're slowly seeing like porous boundaries between all of these institutions, I think.
I agree. I think there's a really good example, the New Museum Triennial, which was in 2015, which was curated by Ryan Tricarton and Lizzie Fitch, who were these crazy video artists, and a lot of the work was like 3D printed sculptures or video, and there was actually textile work within that exhibition, which was very, very contemporary. So I think especially as our relationship changes to textiles, like with fast fashion and these crafts that are dying out, I think it's more important than ever that we really see it everywhere.
Okay, I'd like to just move on a little bit from there, but sort of based on the same, some of the same issues. As our discourse has evolved from modernism to postmodernism and postcolonialism, our ideas of what constitutes an artwork have changed. In many ways, this has to do with interests in interdisciplinarity, or works that span different traditions, and history, works that boldly acknowledge the artistic traditions from which they spring. Going back to Octavio Paz, he claims that, quote, handcrafted artifacts do not march in lockstep with time, nor do they attempt to overcome it. Craftsmanship is the heartbeat of human time. If we were to take the pulse of craft today, what would it tell us, and where would we see it these days?
Okay. I don't know. I feel like I want to have faith in new generations that they are dexterous and they are learning how to knit, crochet, sew, work with clay, everything. But I'm honestly worried that those kind of human traditions are gonna fall out of favor because of technology. And so I feel like I see that present within my generation. I see it present within generations that are younger, that it's just not something that they wanna do. So it's absolutely something that I worry about, that it's maybe only becoming this art sort of aspect of like human, being a human, rather than just something that you do or that you learn or that you teach.
So you mean that it's becoming just part of high art institutions? Is that what you're saying?
I think that's what I'm worried about.
Uh-huh. It's an interesting question, because the Octavio Paz piece, it's been a long time since I've read it, but it makes an equation between craft and like geological time, right? It is outside of human time. So therefore, it is special, it's different, it's very romantic, right? That sort of understanding of craft in the hand. So I wouldn't like, I'm not a big fan of that definition of craft, because I think it creates a kind of conservatism about like, it is outside of time. And maybe it even connects to this desire or this fear that it always needs preserving, in some sense. We do have moments, of revival of craft, like of course the 60s counterculture, that whole, community or field or scene, however you want to describe it, there was a major revival of craft in North America that had to do, it was so integrated into people's lifestyle that it was both everywhere and nowhere. Like, it wasn't like identified per se, but like, it, you know, whether you were making your own clothes, we have an exhibition that's coming to MAD in a couple of weeks that's just about the handmade clothing of the counterculture. It was about house building, which people saw as like an extension of their sculptural practice. It was, it extended into kinds of activities that only now museums are beginning to recognize as art forms, like cooking or gardening, right? Or growing your own food, right? These are suddenly seen as like creative practices in ways that they weren't, although recognized within counterculture kind of milieus. But now I don't know where I'm going with that. Because like, I don't know if I'm so concerned about the preservation of craft. Because I think there's historical circumstances that often come together to create these kinds of revivals, and people use it for purposes of like reimagining for the counterculture, just reimagining civilization from the ground up. I don't know what it would look like as a part of a mass movement today. We have some inklings of it, right? Because we did experience a craft revival not too long ago. We're still kind of in the middle of it. I would say that relates to like DIY culture, craftivism, a feminist revival of craft, especially as it relates to needlework and knitting and crochet, etc. So I feel like I see people using these skills all the time as part of a lifestyle. Like, they're not that interested in whether it's art or even craft for that sense. It's just integrated into the way that they live, and it has very specific, in some cases, like political associations about their lifestyle and how they decide to live their life. So I see it practiced, but yeah, but I also see it as entering the contemporary art world in ways that you never in my lifetime would I have imagined it, like with Sarah's work or something like that. So maybe it's going to happen in both places. I don't know. Because, you know, in the 60s and 70s, that craft revival, you know, for artists who were working in textiles, really they had to carefully distinguish themselves from that popular kind of work, right? But nowadays, I see artists who openly integrate that those popular styles or that those kind of lifestyle, the lifestyle ethos into their work. Like it's that conversation and that kind of amateur practice has become really central to the contemporary art world. And it is a legitimate subject because it connects to gender and race and politics and all these things which are now relevant or part of a conversation in art world that did not exist in that time period. So the same obstacles that artists in the 60s and 70s really struggled with just aren't there anymore because they've become central to artistic practice.
Yeah, and I'm not, I really wasn't thinking of the Octavio Paz essay as being a model for us today. You know, but I do think it was very much part of its time and we are living with that legacy today. You know, and interested in looking at what's happening today that will be that legacy that, that carries forward. Certainly, Paz is very romantic about this idea about, you know, the mark of the hand in contemporary or in craft. And for me, there's a real question there because craft has, I think, always utilized technology. You know, and whether that is the potter's wheel, the loom, I don't know, saw.
What's really made by hand.
Hand, exactly. When you take a
look. Right. Yeah. There's tools involved.
With everything. Yeah. And so with a piece of furniture, you know, all the types of power tools that go into it. Mm-hmm. But you express concern about sort of the disappearance. There are so many ways these days of looking at 3D production. Scanning things, putting them together, reassembling them. How will that affect craft? Well, how is it affecting craft right now? And what's your feeling about the future?
Well, one example I can think of is an exhibition that was at MAD not too long ago, which is the furniture of Wendell Castle. And he has integrated, you know, robots and all that into the making of his furniture because for him it's a tool that allows him to create forms that you can't do by hand. Like it's impossible to make your body or work a piece of wood in a shape because of the limitations of the way the arm is, you know, etc. So he can create that through those robotic machines. In his mind, I don't think it doesn't have anything to do with lessening, say, the authenticity of his work or his commitment to craft or anything like that. So I guess I'm not quite, like, for 3D modeling, am I worried about it? No. I'm still waiting for what's interesting about it, tell you the honest to God truth.
I agree. I think technology can be used as a crutch or it can be used like really intelligently. I'm going to say this again, it worries me, of course, that like people are going to lose these traditions. But again, for every front lash, there's a backlash. So I'm sure if we're getting these 3D printed Afghans, there will be someone there to make something that is like an incredible response.
With all changes in technologies, I think. Yeah. Tonight's event is also an acknowledgement of textile traditions and legacies. Well, both Sheila Hicks and you have looked to textile traditions, particularly those in South America. The exhibition In Praise of Hands, going back to that, really looked at craft activity from around the world. How how do we see globalization of craft as opposed to an idea of perhaps appropriation of craft techniques and traditions?
I can definitely talk about globalization in that just seeing the change in Peru because of tourism, there's such a, it's this incredibly historically rich country where even in Lima, which is very urban, like you can see women spinning yarn on a drop spindle in their pocket. But what you can see being changed is what they're producing, where like a tourist will want to buy like a little stuffed hand knit llama versus something that's like culturally important. So I have witnessed change in terms of that, in terms of what people want to make or need to make money. And but I think also it's with globalization, there's been this really great exchange of ideas. And in terms of appropriation, like I think that gets really tricky. But I think again, if there's a level of respect and acknowledgement of where these specific techniques or cultures or inspiration is coming from, that's when it's not theft.
Related to the issue of tourist craft, I really think that's a great example of how in the craft world we have our own hierarchies and boundaries and limits, and I don't think we know what to do with tourist art. Like, why is that not legitimate craft, right? Just because there's foreigners who come and buy it, they're responding, artists are responding to a market that exists. They want to, you know, live off the work. Some of it is exquisitely made, right? So it's a hard thing. I see this in the pages of the Journal of Modern Craft all the time, like how to approach tourist craft. It's quite often anthropologists who will look at it as opposed to art historians, which tells you already like just difference of interest in what kinds of objects that you want to pay attention to or you think are valuable or not. So, I mean, it's a great example of how we have our own horizon of expectations that doesn't include, you know, a lot that's made in the craft world. And you begin to see it begins to be exposed once you think about craft globally.
Thank you. All right, I think it's probably time to open it up to your questions. So do people have questions or comments for either Elisa or Sarah?
We love you, speech.
Yep, Suzanne?
I think it is interesting, and it's of course a sign that we're in the middle of a moment where people are very invested in craft and like the handmade, and it says something about your identity and who you want to be and how you want to live in the world if you're going to associate yourself with those styles, right? So it's almost like you don't have to do the making. Is it like a shopping movement? Like there's something I haven't quite like, you know, really theorized it, but it is really fascinating. And a lot of those values, I have to say, that we associate with the handmade and craft come straight from the counterculture, right? Because they were revived at that moment too, and they were very associated with an idea of rejection of the status quo, rejection of nonstop consumption, return to the land, or some respect for nature, and it was tied to the use of particular set of materials that were outside of the realm of the contemporary art world, which was considered, you know, like a bankrupt, high, elite world. So I think they're also still selling that, which is really fascinating to me that it's survived this long, or I guess survived the backlash of the 80s, right? And it still carries a lot of those connotations for people. I've never really looked into like the supply chain, like who exactly is making these works. Is this like just another example of like global outsourcing? And if so, you're participating in that. And I can imagine that most people who are attracted to the values of craft as they have historically been connected to politics would be appalled to think that they might also be like exploiting labor like overseas. It doesn't always happen that way, but I know in some cases, of course, that's what's going on if you're going to scale it up, right? To the, and have it at this this price point that's accessible to a broad audience.
But manufacturing something that looks handmade really does reflect back, I would think, at the importance of, or the perceived importance of craft activity, to sort of build that into a production which must, you know, cost, you know, a fair amount to differentiate those objects from the other ones sitting on the big box shelves.
Kai.
The higher end,
so
right?
So you mean it's like it's actually not for a broad audience. It's really an elite practice. Yeah, yeah. Yeah, I see that. I absolutely see that, especially in jewelry. You're right. And there's a trend right now to use a lot of precious gems and gold, and that really wasn't part of like the sort of art jewelry tradition in the first place. It was it veered away from that. Yeah, I've seen it.
I thought there was.
Okay.
Yep. Were you saying? No. I thought I was just gonna. I thought we saw a hand over
there. There are two. I think there are two. Yep.
So I have a question about like the art market in the United States and sort of the response to craft, because so in the western part of the United States, you go to some of these sort of tourism towns and you see very high-end and, you know, textiles and, mm-hmm. and weavings and things like that. And I just wondered, and there's a lot of people I know that are very interested in that and they actually practice it themselves. And they know a lot about sort of the regional, you know, regional artists and things like that. And I just wonder how is that sort of interest? It seems like there's a more of a public interest in craft and textiles in the United States. I wonder if that, is that driving the art market at all? Is it making things more interesting to the public? Are you getting mm-hmm. more sort of, you know, like broad scale interest mm-hmm. in pieces?
I can definitely say for me, craft. I feel like I probably get more interest in my work versus if I'm making something that's like deeply theoretical and not as aesthetic. So I can only speak for my experience, but yes, I feel like I get more interest because it is like more accessible. I think.
I mean, the other thing I would say is that I think the phenomenon you're describing is a good example of the fact that there's just like multiple markets out there. There's not like a single market. The one that most art reporters pay attention to is like the most elite, like blue chip markets that exist in New York City and other European art centers. But honestly, there's so many different markets. And if you just step away for 1 second, you begin to see like, oh, this is a much broader constellation. And I don't know to what extent the, like, let's just say the Chelsea contemporary art market in New York City really dominates anything when you start to look at these other markets, which are very robust. just thinking of also like art markets in places like Santa Fe, right? There are, it's often touted as like the most money that's you know, spent on art happens there. That is not a market that intersects with a contemporary art market in New York City at all, but it's extremely viable and dynamic.
Okay, oh, yes.
I mean, I'm aware of the trend that you're talking about, right? So you want to move away from like a kind of product design that's like toasters or something, right? To something where you work directly with an artisan on a relatively, has to be relatively small scale, I would assume. It sounds like you're doing it. Yeah, that's true. That's true. Like sometimes you see it scaled up, but for the most part, it seems rather, you know, it's like artisan workshop level. There's an interesting organization that I have recently gotten to know in New York City called Nest. I don't know if you're familiar with them. You would probably be interested. So they don't create partnerships between a designer such as yourself and an artisan in India, let's say, and ask that artisan to make a product that will actually sell in, say, North America or Western Europe. So they're not looking to help that artisan transform their skills to suit a different market. They will actually look for artists and artisans and craftspeople around the world that can't reach their full potential for a variety of reasons, and then give them direct grants. So for instance, they might work with someone in India who's the last remaining producer of a particular kind of silk. But the person can't work in the rainy season because they have a hole in their roof and it would ruin ruins the workshop, right? So they will just simply give a grant to build a new roof so that person can maintain production throughout the year and potentially expand their own market. It's interesting. In this year, they brought artisans to the United States to actually meet with people in the fashion industry. Again, not to really create deals, but to allow them to understand how like a production chain works like within the fashion industry. And now they're starting to work with artisans in the United States. Like they introduced to me, this is why I was talking to them, the idea that they would like to go into places like Colorado and Arizona and New Mexico and work directly with Native American artists who might also be facing the same problems that prevent them from expanding or taking on an apprentice or investing in the materials they need to create a project or something like that. I found that to be very refreshing, the expectation is not that you're going to make this person conform to a foreign market in some way.
That's an important part of it. It's because I think there have been projects in the past where basically it's been, okay, there is a market for this. You have these skills, but you need to really completely change the approach in order to feed the market.
Right, exactly. And so that's the only way you're going to survive.
So how do you create that balance between the traditions and the market, I guess?
I I feel like it's interesting too right now. I feel like I keep hearing that conversation between art versus design, and it feels very similar to craft versus art. It's getting into these weird gray areas with production and intention and authorship. And I don't know, it's just, I have a strange like aversion towards the term design, just because it puts you into like, again, a different market. And so it's, I don't know, it's just weird, very weird.
Okay, that's Karen.
You're talking about like can virtuosity or mastery actually have any traction in the contemporary art world? Yeah, that's a good question, because you know, historically it's the opposite, right? Like you privilege the idea and the concept over a mastery of a material, and it's the one thing that craft artists are really resistant to. Like, no, really, it is about mastering the wheel or you know textiles or whatever, however you want to describe it. And what happens is, especially under modernism, if you're not like everything that's outside of the intellectual is just reduced to like some superficial like decorative amusement, right? Like it can never be seen as an intellectual project to know materials really well or to master them or to exhibit virtuosity. I still think the virtuosity is a big problem. And if you want to work in, like, let's just take the example of ceramic sculpture right now, which is really experienced an upswing in New York fine art markets. It is really not ceramics that show or display virtuosity and mastery over the material. Now, that's not to say these artists who are producing these large-scale ceramic sculptures aren't masters. I would say that they are very, very skilled. But the style of their work is speaking to an audience that doesn't value mastery. And they're interested, too, in thinking beyond that. And so a very typical style of contemporary ceramic sculpture right now looks like the legacy of Peter Volkis, right? But even more, in some cases, maybe more abject or more violent or more casual and amateur looking, right? And so that's a very, I hear these conversations among ceramicists all the time, like how appalled they are. So there's one side that's really appalled that there's not the expression of virtuosity. And the other side is like, well, but that's just not what I want to do. Right, and I do feel this is a collision of two very different approaches to process and material, and I think it will just continue for quite some time. Yeah, mm-hmm.
I agree. I think that's kind of what I was thinking in like an extreme scenario where technology has just like wiped out so much human information that like that's the scenario that would be. But that's also, there's so many contributing factors. We don't know what's going to happen. Again, I feel like we're at this like very strange transition time where there are a lot of things that are being handmade, but there's also a lot that's done technologically. So I hope that never happens.
Here's a weird scenario. Like, if you're thinking apocalyptic, like I can imagine a situation where you have the expansion of artistic practice that's so wide. For instance, right now you have people who call themselves latte artists, or they're working in food some like a food industry, and they see themselves and strongly identify as artists. Personally, I'm okay with that. If that's where they see their creative practice, that's fine. In fact, in some ways, it's like a realization of an avant-garde utopian vision of art actually being integrated into life in some way. So it seems important to me that this has happened, right? That it's far exceeded the boundaries of the art world, even if the art world doesn't pay attention to it or makes fun of it. So you could conceivably have a situation where what happens is that what's left for museums is just called museum art. And it is essentially just virtuosic technique, right? And the rest, what's interesting about art and creative practice and living your life as a creative person actually just exists outside of those institutions. Could happen. Probably not tomorrow, but, you know, in some, yeah.
Sorry. Any other questions?
There, I know, the last, I actually thought of this when you were talking about, like, this bohemian art utopia, that I walked by, like, a food pop-up that said, like, every restaurant was curated. So I feel like we're also in this, like, very, like, dangerous, like, area with language, certainly in the United States, with alternative facts. And also the internet, it's the way that people are speaking and communicating to each other is, again, I feel like very transitional. So we're in a very, very interesting time in terms of language and what exactly it means.
I was gonna say, coming from Colorado, like, it's just the dream of every artisanal entrepreneur, right? Right down from craft beer and spirits all the way down to marijuana. It's all the same. It's very, very highly engineered, and these are smart people, and I understand why they understand themselves as creative people and will call themselves artists. I don't have an issue with it. But the same thing has happened with, like, the term curator. But maybe for slightly different reasons, like, partly I just see it as a response to the fact that there's just too much stuff in the world. And, like, even I rely on people to filter it for me. You know, I'm happy when someone sends me a list of, like, don't forget to go see these three shows. I'm like, thank you. Be like, you've curated my weekend for me. Or, like, it's just a complete overload. And so what happens is that it's no surprise that people start curating food and they start curating selections of literally everything, because you can't really manage it on your own anymore. There's no way that you can have mastery over what's in the world. There's like an implicit value judgment within those lists or curatorial kind of practices that exist outside the art world. So there's something about it that does actually connect to the way curators might function in institutions, where they're also meant to make choices and make value judgments. But yeah, it gets watered down, it does. But it doesn't, I don't know if it bothers me that much, because I really rely on other people to filter as much as they rely on me to filter, right, what goes into the museum.
But don't you think there's a little bit of a dilemma with the idea of craft and craft as far as breweries using it, as this idea of, I don't know, prestige, quite honestly, and excellence.
Oh, yeah.
And meanwhile, yeah, those of us within the field, uh-huh, are sort of debating about what it is and,
yeah,
what we should be, you know,
they
how we should
long
be.
Long past that conversation to just say, yeah, I'm going to associate my brand with this ethos and everything that it means to a popular audience. Yeah. I mean, and to a certain extent, what happens is that, of course, you'll see, you know, corporations also appropriate it. And that's where I think most people are like, oh, God, this is the end of the line for that word now, you know, once that happens.
Yeah, it can go back to the mass-produced handmade item. It's you're selling a lifestyle. There's a particular aesthetic that's popular right now, or what businesses want to appeal to. So it just... You know, yeah, they right. They know it's a lifestyle, or at least like a certain taste.
Right. Yeah, but it also has to do with excellence. I think, you know, car companies use it to say, you know, the crafted interiors of their cars, which, you know, they see that as being something that is worth expressing and promoting, and yet we sit and debate it, I guess. Anyway. All right, Sarah, over to you.
Well, thank you all for coming this evening, and I don't know, I think we ended up at shopping. I'm pretty sure we ended up talking about shopping. But we started from a very real place and came back to a very real place of everyday activities, of consuming, of making, of purchasing, of sharing and communicating. And I want to thank you, Sarah, Alyssa, Alan, for taking us through your journey this evening. And thank you all for coming. Please join me in thanking our three guests.